BFBS.
This is the Forces Station.
He's back with a new album full of romantic Italian Riviera. It's called Serenata, and I'm very pleased to welcome to BFBS Radio, Alfie Boe. Alfie, thanks for joining us here on BFBS. Great new album, I have to say, Serenata. I've had it a few days now, and it's just sat in my car, and and it's really good. How would you describe your singing? Are you opera? Are you pop? Are you a crooner with an operatic tendency?
Yeah. I'm a bit confusing. I'm a trained opera singer. I went to the Royal College of Music and studied, and so I've gone through all the technical approach to singing, but my interest in music is very varied. You know, I love rock music, I love pop, I love classical, I love all types of music, really. I basically try and sing songs that suit my voice. I just sing songs that appeal to me, that seem to bring something out of my voice, and yeah, that's just what I go for, even if it's so from a classical aria to a rock song or some, you know, whatever it is.
We're going to play some music. You're going to do a live session for us as well from the new album. Let's go right back to your beginning. Tell us a little bit about yourself. You've got a bit of a strange mix of Norwegian and Irish in there somewhere.
My dad's side of the family were Norwegian, my mother's side were Irish. But we grew up in Lancashire, in the north of England. I was a car mechanic as well in Blackpool.
TVR factory, TVR, not just any right. car. I mean, no, that's no, a pretty no. good car, isn't it? That's quite right. cool.
Well, it was good. I mean, I was involved in the paint jobs and, you know, all the under... started off working there, pretty low job. It was like called the matte blacker. So I was spraying the undercoats, sealing the bonnets and the doors with this protectant matte black paint, you know. Then I finally got to a point where I was getting experience on the end of the line, which is basically when the car is finished and painted and pristine.
Was music and singing a part of your life then?
Yeah,
you started performing fairly early on in your teens, didn't you?
About 14, I started being a part of amateur operatics, that sort of thing. I packed it in for a while so I could concentrate on my apprenticeship in the garage, but then I got the urge again to just sing. I don't know what it was, a feeling inside that I just thought, I've got to get back on stage. And so I auditioned for another local company who were doing a production of West Side Story, and they took me on. They gave me the main role, actually, in that, which was pretty cool. And then while I was working at the garage, I was singing along to the radio one day, and I was working on this fella's car at the end of the line, and he said, look, I think you've got a really good voice. You should try and do something with it. And he was in the music industry in some way, and he said, look, there's a company in Birmingham that are auditioning for their next UK tour, but they're auditioning in London, so take a day off work, go to London and check it out. So I did, sang to them, went back for a second audition, and then they offered me the job with on their next UK tour, and that was how it all started, really.
So it's almost a rags to riches, literally an oily rag to riches, isn't it, for you?
I went back, handed in my notice, and left to go on the road with an opera company, which was, my foreman at work thought I was absolutely crazy. But,
How big a leap is it, Alfie, from singing to the radio in a car factory to then literally becoming professional? Is it quite a big leap for you?
It is a big leap. I mean, the people that you work with in a car factory are very, very different than the people you work with on stage in an opera company.
Have you got people in the back saying, shut up and do the car?
Yeah, exactly. Stop singing and just polish the bloody car, you know? It's like, no, it is a very different world, and it did take a bit of getting used to. The thing that I mainly focused on was just the performing side. You know, I never really thought about the atmosphere of the room and of the people that you're working with. You know, the thing that I was mainly focused on and concentrating on was, this was my first professional job. I wanted to impress and I wanted to do well. And I loved it. I loved every minute. I learned so much on that job. And from that, I went to music college.
And I guess an added pressure, in so much as now it's your living, it's not something you do as a hobby, and nothing to fall back on, because I presume you gave up everything to take up singing.
Yeah, I look back and you think, you know, I was in a job where I was getting a regular wage. It wasn't much of a wage, but it was something. And I could have got a pension and gone all through that, through the company, built myself up and all that. But then, you go into this business and it is a bit unknown. It can be a little bit of a fickle business, and you don't know whether it's going to stop the following week or whatever. It's an interesting journey.
Our first piece that we're going to play, hopefully the fans are going to like it, because it's one of my favourite tracks, but it's back to 2013 and the Trust album. Keep Me In Your Heart, the Warren Zevon song, is the first one we're going to play. How big an album was Trust for you?
It was important for me, actually. It was a really important one. I tried to connect with some of the Americana folk songs. There were a number of songs that I chose that didn't make the album. The songs that did make it, like the Keep Me In Your Heart, is just sensational. I love that song. Yeah. It's beautiful. Warren Zevon was an amazing singer-songwriter. The producer that did the album, Larry Klein, worked with Warren a lot. And the band on there were sensational. We had Booker T. Jones from Booker T. and the MGs playing Hammond organ on it. And yeah, it is. It's a great song to play. I love to sing it.
Shadows are falling and I'm running out of breath. Keep me in your heart for a while. If I leave you, it doesn't mean I love you any less. Keep me in your heart for a while. When you get up in the morning and you see that crazy sun, keep me in your heart for a while. There's a train leaving nightly call when all is said and done. Keep me in your heart for a while. Sha-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-
It's Keep Me In Your Heart from the 2013 album of Alfie Boe and Trust, and Alfie's with us here on BFBS. Alfie, your wife, Sarah, and children, Gracie and Alfie Jr., I suppose, get very fond mentions in the credits on Trust. Is family an important thing to you?
Yeah, it is. It's very important to me. You know, I'm sure some of the guys overseas can relate to this, and I don't have it half as bad as they do, but I'm away from my family a lot. You know, with the touring and the travelling and the promotion work, it's quite difficult, and it can be really hard. So when you have an opportunity to present a body of work that is really sentimental to you and emotional and dedicated to your family, then that's a blessing, really. You know, but this job can be hard when you're away from your kids and your wife. So I feel for all those guys that are away from their families and the men and women that are overseas doing such a wonderful job. It's hard.
And it's interesting because particularly in our operational areas, music plays a really big part when people are separated, particularly in operational. It's interesting that you say, you know, I presume your music as well brings the family together as well. Because you met your wife in America, didn't you?
I did, yeah. I was rehearsing a show over in America and were rehearsing in the building where she was studying, and we had met over a pot of tea, and I asked her out that night, and within a year or so we were married. We've been happily married for 10 years now, 11 years. We've known each other for 12 years, but yeah, 10 years we've been married, and two beautiful kids. And yeah, like you say, music does bring families together, and that's what I want to try and do with all my albums, is for just supply a little bit of joy to people that need it, and maybe one or two songs that they connect with on an album that means something to them. Or so it's nice to think that the stuff I'm producing is really benefiting someone.
Mm. Do the children keep it young and fresh? Have they got their favourites? Are they, oh, Dad, can you record that for us?
Well, my little girl loves me to sing In My Daughter's Eyes, simply because she knows what it means now. It's basically about her, so I can't not, you know, every time I'm singing that song for her.
Let's play another track, the final cool. one from Trust, if I may, because it's one of my favourites. Jimmy Cliff and UB40, of course, performed it as well. I think it's one of those you mentioned earlier about how songs show off your voice and your vocal range, etc. And this one is for me, Many Rivers to Cross. Yeah. How did that come out? Does that mean something to you?
Yeah, this song was a big song for me on the album. The Trust album, you know, is a bit diversifying from my regular sort of route. The Storyteller was the first step, then I brought Trust out, so it was a bit of a gamble to go from what I had been recording to this type of music. Even though I thought the songs were strong and powerful and sat with everything else that I was doing, I thought I wasn't really going too far away from things. So that's what this song really means to me, is that there's lots of barriers to get through, emotional times, whether it's business, personal, whatever. But basically on the other side, it's a clear road. You get to your goal. You reach your happiness.
I got many rivers to cross, but I can't seem to find my way. As I travel along, white cliffs of Dover, I got many rivers to cross, and it's only my will keeps me alive. Some dream.
We're in conversation with Alfie Boe here on BFBS, and that was Many Rivers to Cross from the Trust album of last year. Are you a spiritual person, Alfie? Because there's a fair bit of spiritualness on that album, and perhaps gospel music, and that does favour a big booming voice like yours.
Yeah, I mean, music in that field of repertoire is just very spiritual. It's fantastic. The gospel stuff is powerful music. Mm. You know, you go to a gospel church and you see these choirs up there just giving it everything that they've got, you know, giving it just their heart and soul, and they know, they mean every word that they're singing. They're putting every ounce of energy into singing it, and it's raw emotion.
Mm. And uplifting,
and
too,
very uplifting,
it,
you know? Very uplifting. They say that they're just putting prayers to music, but that's in a way what music is to me sometimes. You know, you're putting across an emotion, you're putting across a sentiment.
Do you find that you get into a song when it does have that gospel spiritual side to it?
Yeah, I do. I mean, there's another song on there, Glory, Glory.
Yeah, which is like a bit of an Elvis tinge to it as well.
Elvis was a big influence of mine. I loved his performances and his voice and the way he could deliver a song.
We spoke about diversification and everything. Let's talk about TV acting, because you were in Mr. Selfridge as well. I'm a bit typecast, playing the tenor. But how was that? Was that fairly easy to transition across and do that?
It was basically the performance and the singing was fine. Doing that, that was all cool. The acting side, I had a couple of scenes where I had to speak dialogue, and so that was different. I'd not really done anything like that as far as television before. I thoroughly enjoyed it, because it was new to me. And I learned a lot from all the other actors, watching them perform, watching them deliver their lines, and understanding how they did it. And on a job like that, when you haven't done it before, you really have to learn fast. Yeah. You really have to observe and learn how, you know, watch everybody else's technique and try and fit in. And I think it came across okay. I loved it. I really did enjoy it.
And I guess absolutely different from your stage work, of course, with Les Mis, where you're a bigger live audience, but you're so much more removed from it in terms of the TV recording too.
You know, with live performance, if you do have any dialogue, there is an element of you having to project it, you know, for the theatre. But on television, you can speak just as we're talking now, very quietly, and just keep the dialogue down, keep the volume down, because there is literally a microphone right here picking you up. So I found that quite interesting, that they would be going through their dialogue. I thought it would be big and brash Mr. Selfridge, this, and blah, blah, blah. But it was like, you know, it was really quiet and delicate. And I thought, wow. And so I was trying to listen in to get the my cue, you know, to walk out and say it was quite funny to do that. But no, very, very cool.
Would you like to do more of it?
I would love to do more. I really would, I would love to do some more TV work.
Well, time for you to sing for your supper. You're going to do some live stuff for us, aren't you? We're going to get the crowd and everything out. What's the first piece you're going to perform for us? I think it's from the new album, Serenata, isn't it?
Yeah, this is called Chitarra Romana, which means Guitars of Rome. It's actually originally quite a slow ballad. It's really very gentle and slow. But we decided to give it a bit of a twist and up-tempo it a little bit and put a bit of rhythm guitar in there. And because the song is about guitars, you know, basically on how vibrant they can be, how romantic they can be, how they can serenade people on balconies and all that sort of stuff. And it's such a wonderful instrument in this type of music. It sort of leads all the tracks. So yeah, this is Chitarra Romana.
Suona, suona mia chitarra, lascia piangere il mio cuore, senza casa e senza amore rimani solo tu. Se la voce intoverata accompagnami in sordina la mia bella fornita al balcone non c'è più. Sotto mando di stelle Roma bella mi appare, solitare il mio cuor disilluso d'amor può nell'ombra cantar. Una muta fontana e in balcone lassù, o chitarra romana accompagnami tu. Suona, suona mia chitarra, lascia piangere il mio cuore, senza casa e senza amore, mi rimani solo tu. Se la voce impavelata accompagnami in sordina, la mia bella forlina al balcone non c'è più. Lungo Tevere dorme mentre il fiume cammina, io lo seguo perché mi trascina con sé tra voi quel mio cuore. Vedo un'ombra lontana e un balcone lassù. Oh chitarra romana, accompagnami tu. Suona, suona mia chitarra, lascia piangere il mio cuore. Senza casa e senza amore, mi rimani solo tu. Se la voce impovelata accompagnami in sordina, la mia bella forlina al balcone non c'è più. Suona mia chitarra, lascia piangere il mio cuore. Senza casa e senza amore, mi rimani solo tu. Se la voce impovelata accompagnami in sordina, la mia bella fornarina al balcone non c'è.
From the new album Serenata, Guitarra Romana, from Alfie Boe, who's with us here on BFBS. We've got the gang in from the office and the studio and everything there. Does that help when you're actually singing live?
It's nice, and it's nice for this sort of music to give it that sort of party atmosphere, you know. It's nice to perform in front of a crowd as well. The reason why I invited everyone in was just to capture that party feel, that sort of atmospheric, joyful feel that these songs produce, you know, yeah. These songs give out, and they certainly rise to the occasion, you know.
I mean, we've come right up to date with the new album Serenata in there. Have your musical influences, you mentioned Elvis, but have other influences influenced you in particularly in this album? I mean, Pavarotti, Dean Martin, Frank Sinatra, they're all mentioned in some of the preamble to the new album. Have they influenced you with the Italian feel as well?
They have. The thing that influenced me the most on these sort of songs was the fact that contemporary artists have sung them, you know, like Elvis, like Dean Martin, and put their own little stamp on them. And it's really cool. That I love that. But then when you look at the classical artists, you've got people like Giuseppe Di Stefano, you've got people like Enrico Caruso and Gigli. Everybody's, all those guys have sung them too, and Pavarotti made a lot of these famous. But the contemporary style of performing for these songs is something that's very important to me, because it makes these songs the people's songs, you know, sort of brings it to a wider audience in a sense, you know. Not to disregard the classical audience, I mean, they know these songs anyway, but it's nice to introduce an audience that might not have had the experience of listening to Pavarotti or sing these sort of things, you know. So I do try and put the Dean Martin influence into a lot of the production of them.
How much research has gone into the actual tracks? Because there must be hundreds of tracks also that you're unaware of in that particular, you know, whether it being, you know, folk songs and that sort of stuff. There must be stuff from, you know, miles away that you've not been aware of.
I think when I was coming up with the list of songs, my shortlist had about 250 songs on it. That was my shortlist. Keep you going for a while. Just a long journey. Then I narrowed it down. It was so difficult because I know all these songs and they were wonderful songs to choose. Well, I have to get well-known songs on there. Songs that people really know.
Familiarity is quite important,
yeah. So I got as many on there as I possibly could think of, and finally got down to like 20 tracks, and then we started picking out the ones for this album.
How much influence do you have on the tracks that you're going to be playing?
Fair bit. It is a collaboration sometimes with the record company. They come up with ideas as well, which is cool because they know my voice and they might suggest a song that I would never have thought of, you know. So it is important to take on their advice too.
And I guess the performance side is important, because once the album's out, you then have the tour and
yeah,
you know, so
yeah,
the actual musical content isn't just for selling albums,
no,
it's for the tour as well.
It's completely, yeah, that's very true. My tour starts end of November through until December 13th, 14th. You have to think about that very carefully, you know, to make sure that the songs that you're putting on the album are going to be suitable to be played live.
Yeah.
And a lot of these are. I mean, I mean, 10 out of the 13, 14 tracks that are on there are going to be in the show, at least, you know.
Called on a high, hear my prayer in my need. You have always been there. He is young, he is a friend. Let him rest.
It's a song that's changed my career, you know, and I love singing it. It's one of those songs that people think that you'd get fed up of it and you'd get tired of it. I really don't, you know, I really don't. It can be a technically hard song to sing, but I don't get tired of singing it because I always want to perfect it. I always want to do something different to it. A slight emotional change can make the song turn, you know, completely.
So we're talking Bring Me Home, which you performed in America as well, on the West Lawn of the Capitol in Washington.
That's right,
must have been, speak about emotion, that must have been...
That was incredible.
Big.
Yeah, it was. I mean, on an event like that, which is very similar to Festival of Remembrance, when I performed on that number of times, it's not about you. Those events aren't about you as a performer. Those events are about the soldiers, about the men and women that are fighting, and it's a celebration of their lives, people that have gone, people that have passed, and people that are still doing a service to our country.
Yeah.
So when I turned up to Washington, and I wanted to try and meet as many of the servicemen and women that I possibly could, so I got up at 7 o'clock in the morning and walked through all the memorials around Washington Park, and got to the Lincoln Memorial. And at the back of the Lincoln Memorial, all the Vietnam vets were camping out. And, you know, there's also a huge motorbike rally called Rolling Thunder on the day of the concert. I mean, there's like 50,000 Harley Davidsons just driving up and down. And that's why they call it Rolling Thunder. It's such a noise. But it's wonderful. So all these Vietnam vets are there, and sat down and talking to them all. And one guy that I was chatting to said, "So what are you doing here, son?" And I said, "Well, I'm here singing at the Memorial Day concert at the Capitol this evening." And he said, "That's great, that's great." He said, "Look, I just want you to remember one thing while you're up there." He said, "If you're nervous," he said, "try not to be, because this event is not your event. You're actually representing us." And that hit me hard. Mm. That really hit me hard when he said that. He said, "You're not representing yourself, you're representing us. So when you're singing, think of us sat on the lawn at the other end of the park." And it really was a very emotional moment. He gave me a pin, he gave me like a little badge, put it in my hand, and I held it while I was singing, you know. And
do you feel that emotion from the audience when you perform it?
I do. You know, I mean, that night was incredible. I stood on that stage singing such a poignant song, and something that the POW organisation has as their motto is "Bring Him Home." And so I was singing that and seeing these service guys and men and women that have sat in the front row in wheelchairs and lost limbs and can't see and things like that, and have had so many injuries, and they're beautiful people. Mm. They're wonderful people. And I find that very emotional at the Festival of Remembrance too. I take it very, very seriously, more than probably any national event that I've done. The Festival of Remembrance is a very serious thing for me, because I do feel that I am representing the people that can't be there, the servicemen and women that can't be at an event like that.
Yeah, and of course those who were injured there as well. Because you performed at Canterbury Cathedral as well, didn't you, with Hayley Westenra?
Yeah, a long time ago.
Long time ago. But I mean, that must have been a big event. I suppose all of these things, when you think back on it, it ratifies your decision to move from car body paint spray guy to Capitol Hill and the remembrance services, and that must be the point where you say, this is why I did it, and this has made it worthwhile.
I mean, if once you're given these opportunities to sing and to perform and to, you know, you've got to take them with both hands, because you know why you're doing it. There's a reason why you've been asked to do it, and that's because, you know, you're a performer and you can sing and you've got a nice sound and people connect with you, but then you have the opportunity to perform and do it for the reason that you want to do it for.
Give something back, almost.
Give something back.
It?
Yeah, exactly.
Well, let's do another live session, the second track.
I've told them to kick it up a little bit. I want a bit more noise from them. So
I think you might get it as well.
Really.
It's another track from Serenata, the new album. What track are we going to do this time?
This is a real party atmosphere song, and oh my goodness, everybody's sung this. Dean Martin did a great version of this, but it's Mambo Italiano.
E ritorna tu e Napoli, venendo dall'America, per imparare tutte le canzoni, ma quando canta, che confusion! E mambo, mambo italiano, e mambo.
presi non mambo piemontesi ma è mambo non non è tarantella è mambo non voglio mozzarella non non no mambo italiano prova ad assaggiare più per trilli e baccalà e compa grivali giorno tutto stian cambiando sempre l'italiano ma con il suo mambo lei continua sempre a impetare da cantare soltanto è mambo mambo italiano è mambo mambo italiano no 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 la storia è qui finita non è più partita e da noi sempre all'estate col suo mambo italiano. Calabresi, non un mambo piemontesi, ma hey! Prova ad assaggiare più petrilli e baccalà e ciuppru, tu vuoi mangiare pasta fasul dicendo sempre e bambino, non berri molto vino poi continua sempre a impetare a cantare soltanto e mambo mambo italiano è mambo, mambo italiano, sì sì sì, la storia è qui finita, non è più partita e da noi sempre all'estate col suo mambo italiano.
Dusty Miller in conversation with Alfie Boe has a new album out called Serenata. We're playing tracks from it and some live and some actually off the album. The album's great, Alfie. I was saying earlier, it's just nice to be able to put trust to one side only for a while, with the new album, and it's been playing it in my car. It's great. What's the difference between recording an album, say, for that, and performing live on stage? How does that work for you?
Well, the big difference in recording is that you can stop and start. And if you make a mistake, you know, you can do it again. But in a live performance, you can't do that, you know. On stage, when you're in the middle of a song, you got to keep going to the end, you know. So there's a lot of pressure. You build yourself up to be on good form, to get you through the song, to do it to its full potential, really.
We've seen you, obviously, doing it here live. Even in a studio environment with a very small view of the gang from the office, it was still a performance for you, wasn't it?
Yeah. I mean, every time I sing, even if there was no, you know, even if none of these guys were in there, which they did an incredible job on the last one, even if none of them were in, I'd still have that performance element to the songs. You know, it's important to really sell it, to really put the words across and mean what you're saying.
What sort of pressure does performing live put on your voice?
The best thing for the voice is rest, is sleep. You know, if you're feeling rested, if your body's rested, if you feel healthy and you do a bit of workout, a bit of exercise, then your voice is going to reflect it. Your voice can tell you so many things about yourself. If you're depressed, if you're sad, if you're low, if you're down, if you're tired, your voice will show. So if you have got a sore throat, if you are sick, and I've been like that, and touch wood, I'm not going to be like that on this tour. You know, is that metal? Oh,
that's right.
Metal.
All the fans are touching wood at the moment as well. They got tickets.
Yeah, exactly. But you know, I've never been in a position where I've had to cancel on any major tour. At college, you sort of build up a stamina that gives you the ability to maybe sing through sicknesses and illnesses like that. You know, it is a worrying thing when you do get sick, but you just try and recover and get over it as quick as you possibly can, so you can be back on the road.
Yeah. I mentioned that you'd sung with Hayley Westenra. You've also done Sean Colvin as well in concert, Pavarotti, and all those. Did lots of sort of duet type albums. Is that something that would attract you? Was there something you'd be looking to do in the future?
In future, I really would. I've got a lot of friends that I'd love to sing with. You know, a lot of people in the business that that it'd be great to perform with. Like, you know, there's a good friend of mine is Chrissy Hind.
And good new album that she's got it now as well.
She's awesome. She's somebody that I would love to sing with. She's somebody that I think has an amazing voice, and the collaboration between the two different voices would really work if you pick the right song. I think it'd be pretty cool. I've recorded with Robert Plant from Led Zeppelin as well, and that was a joy. And I'm trying to persuade him to come and join me on my tour for one of the performances. There's a lot of people out there that I'd love to sing with. Somebody who sent me a lovely message on Twitter recently was Sam Bailey, the winner of X Factor. My goodness, she's got a set of pipes on her. She can sing. Yeah.
Barbara Streisand's got a new album, eh? It's an interesting effort. It's all duets.
I don't want to sing with her.
It's called Partners. But she's actually done a duet with Elvis Presley in a virtual way. And you mentioned Elvis being a big influence. Is something like that...
Doing something like that would be interesting. I mean, it'd be nice to sing with them if they were still alive. I've got to say. So you know, if Barbara Streisand, you know, was up for doing anything, I'd jump at the chance. She's an outstanding performer. Mm. Wonderful voice, beautiful singer. There's one person I would love to sing with in that sort of sense, to do a duet with in somebody who's passed, is Freddie Mercury.
Right, yeah.
He's somebody who I would love to have sung with and love to have performed with. He was a massive influence for me. His performance style, his voice as well, you know. So Freddie Mercury, Elvis, those are the guys that really influenced me a lot. But no, if I had that chance to duet with anybody like that, in that sort of way, it'd be Freddie.
Three tenors, of course, in the past. You're a tenor. You've mentioned Freddie Mercury in that. But I mean, would there be a collaboration in that sort of way that you would welcome
in
Russell Watson? Perhaps. Do you know Russell?
I mean, do know Russell. Yeah. I mean, we've never sung together before. But no, if Russell was up for doing something like that, I think we'd
let's throw Andre Bocelli in, and there we go.
I've sorted it for you, really, here,
Alfie. There's no work to be done. Are those two people that you admire as well and like their work?
Yeah, they're great fellas. Andre Bocelli is a wonderful performer, really knows how to sell a song, and has hit a niche in the market that nobody else can touch. And he's dynamic, he really is, and a lot of respect to the guy for what he's achieved over the years.
Let's go to the new album again then, to Serenata, which is out. One of your choices now. You performed two of them live. Which one can we take from the album that is particularly one that you would like us to play?
I suppose there's a contrast to the two that you've already heard. There's a great song called Addio Sogno di Gloria, which is a beautiful Italian ballad. It's fantastic. More of a classically structured Neapolitan song, but that's one of my favourites on the album too, Addio Sogno di Gloria.
Ando ragazzi felici, ando fama la scuola con la cartella tra cola ed in tasca la mela. Per il futuro avevamo vestito di cola, quante speranze di gloria di celebrità. Ma inesorabile il tempo tracciava il cammino, e a testa chino neghiamo nel nostro destino. Addio sogni di gloria, addio castelli in aria. Parlo con sorrore ancora la mia scrivania, cerco a scacciare ma in vano la monotonia. Addio anni gioventù, perché, perché non mi tornate più. Sono una foglia d'autunno che nella tormenta teme il grigiore dei giorni, l'inferno paventa.
la donna sincera aspettai, compagna dei giorni miei, ma in vano cercai, cercai, amore che anche tu non lo sai. La pena continua la doppia partita, faccio non macchia di chiostro, mi tremman le dita. Meglio tacer le memorie, o vecchio cuor mio, sogni di gloria addio.
Another track from Alfie Boe's new album, It's Serenata, and he's here in conversation here on BFBS with me, Dusty Miller. Has the album turned out how you wanted it to, Alfie? Because
yeah.
I would imagine you'd have had a vision sort of in the future when you were recording it. And
yeah,
then when it actually comes out, perhaps it might be a bit different.
A little bit different.
Are you proud of it?
I am proud of it. I think, obviously, with the collaboration of the record company, and you negotiate on certain things on the album and all that sort of stuff, but I think we really have captured what I saw the album as and what the record company see the album as well. We have the lush, beautiful strings on there that give it that romantic, filmic feel.
Mm-hmm.
And we also have the rhythm section, you know, the small band feel, you know, like the street band vibe, which was my direction, really.
Yeah.
You know, I wanted to try and keep the authenticity of these songs quite real. And I think between myself and the record company, we've produced a pretty solid album. You know, I think this is an album that you can put on and sit down if you're having a nice glass of red wine and a pasta or a party even with some of the songs. I hope they can play this at events like that.
There's a real, I mean, Neapolitan Italian feel to it, I think. And when I was listening to it first time, it came to track 5, and I listened, my ears pricked up.
Yeah.
Because it says Luna Malinconia, which is Blue Moon.
Blue Moon, yeah.
And
it's simply that. I mean, the song is Blue Moon, but it's basically in Italian. I heard an old singer called Carlo Butti do a version. This was back in 1933. He recorded this, and he just sang Blue Moon in Italian, and it just hit me hard. I thought, yeah, it's such a beautiful, beautiful track.
You mentioned the arrangement as well, because I think the arrangement for that particular one is fantastic.
Yeah.
It's really good.
We've got nice strings on that give it that sort of lush feel, but we've also just simply played it down with tiny little mandolin,
and
you can imagine yourself lying on a beach somewhere and just chilling, you know, of an evening.
Is the album a journey from sort of first track to 13? Is it set out in that way, or
you do, I mean, it is important to lay the tracks out on an album in a specific order. You can start off with a big thing, or you can start off gently and just gradually build. So it does ebb and flow, and I think we've left the party song Mambo Italiano right to the end, just to leave everybody in the hand. Really, you know, so.
Serenata is literally translated "Sing in Your Honour." Are you singing in anyone's honour in particular? Is it
to the listener? Really, this album is basically the first album where, you know, the dedications that I've put in the album, like you mentioned, with trust. There's a sentiment for my family, but this is the first album that I've really had the opportunity to really dedicate it to. Every album's dedicated to my fans, but this is a bit more of a focused album for my fans. I really want to say, this is for your honour, this is for you guys.
Yeah. And I guess with the new album comes all the rigmarole that comes after the release of it. You're going to be on Strictly, as we're singing on Strictly Come Dancing.
That's quite a big gig
these days, though, isn't it?
It's a great show to be on, yeah.
What's it like singing and having all the razzmatazz and the dancers, because they normally dance to the song, don't they? That must be quite nice.
It is nice. I mean, the first time that, when I did an episode of Strictly a couple of years back where I did Bridge Over Troubled Water on it, and I rehearsed in the afternoon, it's no problem. You know, stood there in the middle of the ballroom floor on my own, singing Bridge Over Troubled Water, and got through the song, and it was fine, and all hunky-dory and all that. Went through a second rehearsal, all fine. Came to the live show. When I started singing, these two dancers just ploughed onto the stage, and I was like, this didn't happen in rehearsal. You didn't tell me about this. And then I was, like, singing, dodging legs and feet, you know, trying to, you know, and it was, but it was a bit of a surprise, but it's nice. And then I did bring him home on it last year, and again the dancers were on the floor, and it was lovely. No, yeah. Really sweet, really, really good bunch of people that do.
Are we going to see Alfie Boe dancing?
No,
perhaps.
No,
no, no chance.
No, oh my goodness. No, I don't think I'm really a dancer. My feet don't work, my legs don't work. I can sing and I can sway a little bit. So, no, but I don't think dancing is really my forte. Maybe that's why you should do Strictly, if it's not your thing.
That's what the fans come to see.
Exactly,
really?
Yeah. Well, they definitely have a laugh with me. Yeah. I think.
But you've got Loose Women as well, you've got Nevermind the Buzzcocks, so it's quite a diverse sort of publicity route,
yeah,
if you like. For
yeah,
the
there's
hour.
Quite a few different things. I think that's the wonderful thing about my audience, is that it is diverse. Mm. You know, I have to sort of try and please many different people in my concerts. You know, the arena tour that I'm doing at the end of the year will have repertoire from my old albums. It'll have the musical theatre stuff in there. It'll have not too much of the contemporary stuff. This show that I'm putting together, I want it to be really theatrical and quite classy. Mm. I want to transport people back to an era and introduce people to an atmospheric, emotional state, if you will. That's how right. I can sort of describe it. It's obviously the serenata music. There's a lot of the older stuff that I did on for the Downton Abbey soundtrack, as well as the musical theatre, as well as the Bring Him Home and the Les Mis sections. And then we're going to end the show with going back to Italy, getting that party atmosphere wound up again.
Finish on a high, yeah. Right, well, ahead of the final track from Serenata, I'd like to say thanks on behalf of myself Pleasure. And all your fans and our audience in the British Forces, of course, for joining us today. It really is a very strong album. Good luck with the tour
Thank you.
As well. I'll look out for you on Strictly and Loose Women and all that sort of stuff. Alfie, which track would you like us to play out with today?
As soon as you mentioned Blue Moon and you like that so much, let's do a bit of Blue Moon.
Alfie, thanks for joining us today. It's been a pleasure. Thank Cheers. You.
Ma tu, pallida luna, perché sei tanto triste, cos'è che non risplendi per me? Lassù, tu puoi vederlo il mio cuore. La delusione d'amore, questo mio grande dolore. Tu sai che i baci sapeva dare, ed anche tu non puoi dimenticare. Forse tu senti la malinconia, forse tu sai che non ritorna più, ma tu, pallida luna, perché sei tanto triste, cos'è? Tu vuoi soffrire con me? Che baci sapeva dare, ad anche tu non puoi dimenticare. Forse tu senti la malinconia,
forse tu sai che non ritorna più. Sei tanto triste cos'è, tu vuoi soffrire con me, tu vuoi soffrire con me, tu vuoi soffrire.
And music for the British forces. This is BFBS Radio 2.